translator and writes in Punjabi and English. She received the Punjabi Academy Award for her anthology of poems, Ik Nadi Sanwali Chahi. Her poetry anthologies have also come out in English and Hindi. Her translations include Stories of the Soil and Poet of the Revolution. She has written the biography of a Dalit activist and singer called The Ballad of Bant Singh. Books edited by her include Our Voices, an anthology of Sark poetry, and Half the Sky and Children of the Night, two collections of Pakistani short stories. Ms. Sunaina Khatru Bhide is a poet, dialogue, and story writer for films. Her first poem was published at the age of 15. She continued writing and exploring different forms of poetic expressions like kavita, English poems, nazams, and doye. Her love of music triggered her interest in poetry. German writer, journalist Tanya Dukas' first two books, twin volumes of poetry, were published while she was still studying her first novel shortly after she graduated. Her books include Horser Zimmer, Hotel Miss Seablick, Portola Drive, and Cafe Brazil. She has also written children's books and plays. Ajin Aarti, who writes in Kannada, has two poetry collections, a play, and two books of translation from English to Kannada. She has two state awards for her poetry collections to her credit. A quiz show on Kannada language and literature, directed by her, holds a record of the longest running quiz show by Limca Book of World Record, completing 2,500 episodes. Over to you, ma'am.
Hello, good morning. I'm Aarti, writing Kannada poetry. We have panelists who are from different background. I would just start with a small discussion on what they are writing and what is modern. The word modern has been discussed yesterday, day before, so much. So I would directly ask Ms. Nirupama Dutt, what do you think, ma'am? What is modern? Because people are discussing about connecting with a new generation. How does poems and the poet connect with a new generation, and what is modern according to you?
You know, modern. Since we have such a long tradition, ours is a culture with a very long poetic tradition, and you know, a very classical tradition of poetry. So whenever we, the new poets, the present day poets, while looking back at the tradition with warmth and with inspiration, yet they try to say something in the present day language and idiom, you know, which is communicative, which reaches out. Because the poets of our ancient times, our classical poets, were at that time talking in an idiom that was known. So modern is when we are talking, telling our story of our times in our own language. I think that is modern.
I think I totally agree with what she has said. And I always feel, because you know, if you read probably Ghalib or any other old poets, sometimes very difficult because our language has changed. Our language is more Hindustani now. So those, whatever we are living, if it reflects, it will connect with more people. For example, Chal Chaya Chaya Vish Gulzar Sahab has written, is originally by
the folk.
Folk, yeah. so at least in Kulesha, right? So Chalthaiya Thaiya is what actually is. So even if we could do that, you know, while we are writing our own poetry and using whatever words are being used, if we could also weave that, and if even if it incites, because I did not know till that time, that, so I kind of it incites the curiosity for the people who like poetry. Even if so, there's another way to being old and new, and still keep it alive. And also, you have to use words which are very relevant. At least that's how I write. So relevance is very important, at least for my poetry. So that I think is important, which is real and relevant.
Yeah, because in Kannada, there's one poet who wrote in 12th century, Akka Mahadevi. She was so modern and so, I can say, she was ahead of her times. She's even now relevant. So I think, don't you feel that modern, the word itself is a cliche and...
Probably. I think some, it depends, are you saying modern in language or modern in thought?
Referring to German literature, I would say that modernism has a lot to do with a style that we authors, we poets, freed ourselves from writing in rhyme, from following a certain syntax, that we had a lot freer use of the words, and that we could also use word creations, word innovations. But I agreed completely that daily life language appearing in poetry was definitely a milestone for modernist poetry.
Okay, thank you. So we can directly go for the reading now. How about starting with you, Madam Nirupama Dutta?
I write in Punjabi, as you've been told. In college days, I started writing in English. Those were the 70s, many movements were on. And it was felt that, you see, creative writing can be done only in your own mother tongue. You know, so while I did my journalism in English, I made it a point to go to Punjabi and write in Punjabi. And when I was writing in English, Youth Times had Kamla Das as the poetry editor. So one would send her small poems and get a little note that I will take this one and why I won't take that one. And then when I moved to Punjabi, we had our Punjabi poet Amrita Preet, who nurtured almost a generation of two poets. Since I will begin by reading a few lines in Punjabi, just to know the rhythm of the language, and then I'll read them in English translation. Buri aurat, this is a wicked woman. Je tusi mere shahar aoge, te buriyan aurtan di fairest vich mera naam hi darj paoge. Mere kol oh sab kuch hai, jo ek buri aurat kol hona bahut lazmi. हाथ में छलकता जाम है, मूंछ बल्दी अग है, मेरा खिलंडरी हासा बड़ा बदनाम है. पैरा थले सड़क है, ऊपर खुला आसमान है, मेरे कोल सैंड का हौसला है, मेरे कोल कैंड का सामान है. The same poem in English. If you come to my city, you are bound to find my name in the roster of wicked women. I have all that it takes to be as wicked as they come. I have a goblet brimming over in my hand. My laughter is known for its abandon. Flames find a home in my mouth. My heart beats and every nerve does a little dance. The road is at my feet and just the sky above. I have the courage to bear and express myself sans fear. When times are changing, you don't realize. It's only when they have changed that you suddenly realize that so much that's different. So I belong to an age where we did write long letters of love, letters of anger, letters of all kinds of letters. So this is a remembrance to the letters written then. In Punjabi, it is kithe hon ge o khat jo keher diya raata baar mein likh likh paaye. Those letters, where must those letters be? Letters written on stormy nights, I sent to many a destination, but never got a reply or even a confirmation. The 12-page long letter I sent to that tall giraffe-like boy who would sit with me, past midnight, talking of celibacy and D.H. Lawrence in the same breath. Yet he was afraid of the balm of touch. So many written letters after that, some harsh, some soft. In one there would be banishment from my life, in another things would be made all right. One letter would want that my books be sent back, the other one would follow a different track. Perhaps these letters I sent after stormy nights to many a destination were written to myself. Why then did I look for a reply or a confirmation? Disaster, on sorrows, on, you know, happenings. And I remember in those times the Jayaprakash Narayan, the leader, was lying in the hospital. And it was that he may pass away any day. So the whole front page had been made with the J.P. Narayan's obituary, news and his achievements. So this is a poem on a newspaper. May I do it in my language? I thought many would have.
Please.
Akhbar udaas hai. Kal lokaan nu masala dena hai. Sweer di chaa de naal. Ik nava din shuru karan le. Par kuch vaparda hi nahi. Mritu suchna tiyar hai. Par kai mahinya to bimar. Virat deta. Mashina de sahare. Aaj fir marda marda bach gaya. थाने तो ना कोई हत्या की खबर है ना आत्महत्या की चुगिया नो किसे अग नहीं लगी किसी हरिजन कुड़ी का बलात्कार नहीं होया दिन बीत रहा है तो कोई हड़ताल नहीं हुई कितने जांच पड़ताल नहीं हुई आज अखबार उदास द मॉर्निंग कप ऑफ टी मस्ट बी स्पाइस्ड अप विद अ जूसी बिट ऑर टू बट नथिंग सीम्स टू हैपन The obituary is ready, but the old ailing leader has survived again with dialysis. The police station reports no murder, no suicide. No shanties have been burnt down. No Dalit girl has been raped. The day is passing and there has been no strike, no price hike. The newspaper is sad today. I live in Chandigarh, which is now growing, but it continues to be a very small place in comparison to Metropolis. And the escape from Chandigarh is to Delhi, you know, which is about 3.5 hours away by train, 5 hours by bus. So there are a number of poems which deal with the two cities. This is called Tale of Two Cities. I have learned well to hide the wounds of one city from the wounds of another, to change myself just a bit on changing a city, laugh loudly one place, smile softly on at the other, in just 5 hours, cross over from the sigh of Shivkumar Batalmi to the notes of Bhimsen Joshi. I have learnt, drifting from city to city, to forget my lost village. Thank you. a poem about moving to the bigger city, leaving my old city. वो कहते सन तू है शहर छाड़ भी दे पर अपना आप ही में छाड़ पाएगा। कुछ देर तक उस पर आए शहर दी अनाम जिंदगी जी लवेंगी अजनबी बन के फिर हौली हौली उड़ेगी रिश्तिया दे जाले किराए दे कमरे दिया दीवारा सजान वास्ते लभेगी कोई साथ अजनबी रस्तिया नू अपना बनान वास्ते सन पता है तेरा बाज नहीं आएगी तू फिर बनेगी तू इश्क हवाए च अपनी रौंद होंद रलान वास्ते वो सच ही कहते सन मुश्किल होंदा है ऐसे शहर जीना जिथे हवा ना पाए कोई जानी पहचानी बार जिथे मस्करिया करती ना आए कोई एक अद्धी रात जिस शहर की ना होए थोड़े को एक चुम्मन सौगात दे टोल मी Leave this city if you must, but you will not be able to leave yourself. For some time, you will live the life of an outsider, but then you will weave webs of relationships to adorn the walls of your rented room. You will look for someone to walk with you on the unknown paths. We know you well. You will not stop at that. You will fall in love all over again. Just Perhaps they were right. It is difficult to live in a city where the breeze does not whisper sweet nothings to you, where there is not one night that can sweep you off your feet, a city that has not given you even the keepsake of a kiss is not your own. Now I come to one of my signature poems. In Punjabi, it's called Hasti Udasi, a laughing sorrow. This is again with rhythm. I'll do it in Punjabi and then read the translation. Aaj di udasi nu main ghar har kis nahi bichhana hai. Inu apne chole ch pa, shehar diya sadkaan te lekar, ida ji par chadna hai. Aaj coffee house de waitra to, muskuraahtaan da udaar liyana hai. लाइब्रेरी दे चपरासी दा कोई पुराना मजाक दोहराना है फुल पहर दे पेड़ कोई फुल चुरा अपने वाला च उदासी दूर करन दे जद ते सारे नुस्के मैं असबा के थक जावांगी ते कुड़ियां दे हॉस्टल दे सामने ढलान ते बैठ अपना सिगरेट सुलगावांगी अज दी कविता जरूर रल जाएगी ते पढ़न वालिया नू बड़ी चिड़ आई वो कहेंगे ऐसा अमृता दौर दिया कवित्रियां दी सीमा है बस एक सिगरेट ही इना दा जीवन बीमा है अपनी सीमावां बारे सोच मैं होर उदास हो जावांगी दोष ता खैर टुटे हुए टाई इश्कां दे नाल आवांगी ते सालम एहसास लगती लगती शहर दे शायर बन जावांगी उहदी एक जेब विच शराब दा अदिया होएगा ते दूजी विच जादुई नजर का कमाल हौली जी मैं भी हो जावांगी नाल वो मैनू जिंदगी दा एक अद्धा मंत्र सिखाएगा अपनी नवी नजम सुना शराब छट देण दी कसम खाएगा मैं भी नेक इरादियां दी फहरिस्त बनावांगी बस एक इश्क होर दी मोहलत मंग अखर अखर हो जाए आई विल नॉट लेट सोरो सिट स्टिल टुडे इन माय होम Pushing it into my chola, I will take it along to the city streets. Today I will steal a bright red gulmohar bloom and put it in my hair. Borrowing smiles from the coffee house waiter, a little joke with the library caretaker I'll share. When all these tricks to cheer a sorrowing day fail, I will sit on the slope outside the girls' hostel and light my cigarette. The ashes will mix for sure in my poem today. Readers will get a chance to say, I'm all wrong. Such are the constraints of poetesses of Amrita Pritham's age. A cigarette is their only solace. Thinking of my constraints, I will be ever so pained blaming it all on my wretched 2½ years, I will go to the poet of the city, looking for life sans restraint. He will have a half a bottle of rum in one pocket and a freshly written poem in the other. He will teach me a mantra or two of life, and reading his new poem, promise to leave drinking for all times. I too will make a list of good resolutions, and seeking time for just one more love, I will turn myself into words. Now, last poem. I have this poem only in English, because it's not a part of memory yet. This is a poem on the 70s. '70s was the time when people like me came of age. So this is a recall of the 70s. In Punjabi we call it Satwa Dahaka or Seventh Decade. The Seventh Decade had a mood all its own. Poetry was always around. The shoulder bore a khadi chola and not a laptop. In this chola were placed the rudiments of life, wounded dreams of revolution, some thoughts borrowed, some one's own, a torch of a cigarette or two, and a red handkerchief too. Walking along mile after mile after mile, turning the wheels of the cycle was the hallmark of this age. No one was in a hurry to make money, build a house, buy new cars, and fill them with gas. Life was not too bad. So what if we were rather broke? My friends of the 70s hum the poems of Fairs, arguing over the plays of Beckett and Brecht. They wish to turn themselves into a play or a poem. Poetry was very close to life. The pen was our pride. When it came to wooing girls, boys had the mantle of Marxism. If that did not work, they fell back on verse. The 70s were full of wanderlust. Well, you are right in saying it was not all hunky-dory, but then that was our story. We knew how to live and die. We did not go seeking gurus to teach us the art to live and the art to die. We was the key word. I, me, mine were less heard. That was a time when we were not so alone. A full caravan moved along. The Seventh Decade had a mood all its own.
Acoustics?
Here.
Yeah, thank you, Nirpamnata. We may go back to a few of your poems later. Now I request Kachru to read our poems.
Thank you so much. I feel like a cricketer who has been told to play cricket after Sachin Tendulkar. I will give you hope. My language has shades of a lot of different languages. My poetry has shades of lot of different languages because I'm born and raised in Kashmir. I'm a Kashmiri Pandit. I'm very proud to be one. Then part of my education happened in Jammu. Then part of my education happened in Pune. And I've been living in Boston for the last 15 years. So my language is all the shades. I want to express gratitude to Bangalore Literature. We did the team of Bangalore Literature Festival for inviting us here. Myself, along with my parents and my brother, and my son, we after 25 years, we decided we'll go to Srinagar in first week of September. What happened with us, everybody knows that. We got rescued by the local Kashmiri Muslims. And we also met people who were rescued by army and everyone. So initially, I thought I'd read a different poem. But after this experience, I just wanted to dedicate a poem, first one, to Kashmir, my birthplace. I dedicate this one to you. Aur fir ek din. पहला मासूम खून का कतरा जब जमीन पे गिरा पहला मासूम खून का कतरा जब जमीन पे गिरा लहू दरिया दरिया लहू कहीं जिस्म कटा कहीं सर फिरा पहला मासूम खून का कतरा जब जमीन पे गिरा, लहू दरिया दरिया लहू, कहीं जिस्म कटा कहीं सर फिरा। खामोश चीखे गूंजी गहरी गूंगी बहरी वादी में, खामोश चीखे गूंजी गहरी गूंगी बहरी वादी में, हमदर्दों ने आंसू छुपाए, कुछ तो रोने से भी खतरा आए। जुर्म भी तो संगीन था, साधे से मजहब और इतने पेचीदा इंसान। जुर्म भी तो संगीन था, बहुत कटे थे मजहबों के नाम पर, बहुत कटे थे तेरा मेरा मेरा तेरा इस बात के अंजाम पर, बहुत कटे थे। ये नंगे कायर पहाड़ भी चुपचाप तकते रहे, बेहिसाब जुर्मों का हिसाब रखते रहे। इंसानी तांडव का तमाशा कुछ और झेला, जालिम मजलूम फौज सबने किरदार बदला। नाजायज उम्मीद को हर जर्रा खलता रहा, पर मौत का कारोबार लगातार चलता रहा। और फिर एक दिन जब सूफियों का दम घुटा तब पहाड़ों का सब्र लुटा, पानी का लहू बहा दरियाओं की नसें टूटी, कायनात की सारी की सारी हदें छूटी। कई मौतों का सोख था, आसमान फूट फूट कर बहा, आंसू पोंछती पर जमीन में इतना दामन कहाँ था। कई मौतों का सोख था, आसमान फूट फूट कर बहा, आंसू पोंछती पर जमीन में इतना दामन कहाँ था। सब समंदर हुआ और सबके ही अंदर हुआ। पानी न मजहब पूछता है नजात, एक जैसी हुई सबकी कब्रें और हुआ सबका ही श्राद्ध। आखिरकार पानी और लहू साथ रोए, एक रंग के गीले बिस्तर में सब साथ सोए। I'll just give a gist of the book. Okay. In the year 1989, first Kashmiri Pandit fell to the bullet of extremists. Those who were not killed, and you know, Kashmiri Muslims who stayed back, were silenced by the gun and could not even cry properly. The deafening silence echoed, but the valley was dumb and deaf to the pain. But the naked mountains, silenced by the gun, kept the score of the infinite sins. Army and the sufferers, the roles changed, but eventually everyone became a victim. Yet the business of death was looming. Until one day, mountains lost patience and they let go of the ends of the world. They had not mourned for so many deaths. There was not enough earth to wipe the tears of the weeping skies. As heavens kept pouring, the veins of the rivers broke and inundated everyone and everything. Water never asks your religion. So, everyone slept in the same grave and the same ritual of Shraddh for everyone. Finally, under the wet blanket, everyone slept together peacefully. मेरी अगली कविता है बेटी। In the year 2012, the plight of Nirbhaya touched millions across the world. While some of us screamed in pain, some shed silent tears and made resolutions. But the fact remains their society is full of hypocrisy. My poem Beti talks about that. Beti. लक्ष्मी से धन मांगे, लक्ष्मी से हम धन मांगे पर संपत्ति लक्ष्मी को मिलती नहीं. लक्ष्मी से धन मांगे पर संपत्ति लक्ष्मी को मिलती नहीं. सरस्वती दे वरदान विद्या का पर घर की सरस्वती लिखती नहीं. सरस्वती दे वरदान विद्या का पर घर की सरस्वती लिखती नहीं. दुर्गा देगी कैसे शक्ति जब अपनी ही रक्षा कर सकती नहीं. दुर्गा देगी कैसे शक्ति जब अपनी ही रक्षा कर सकती नहीं. We have a fixation of fair color in our country. I don't have to prove that. Just look, I mean, you see how many fairness creams are sold on TV. So, just a reference to that. कि शाम कितने भी हो काले, शाम कितने भी हो काले, सांवली राधा बिकती नहीं, सांवली राधा बिकती नहीं. कितने भी विद्वान हो गिरिधर, द्रौपदी तो बचती नहीं, द्रौपदी तो बचती नहीं. हो अगर जन्मी सिया घर सीता, हो अगर जन्मी सिया घर, धूमधाम क्यों दिखती नहीं, धूमधाम क्यों दिखती नहीं. काली को पूजने वाले साली कह के नोचते हैं, काली को पूजने वाले साली कह के नोचते हैं, तो फिर कोप में मुझे मारने वाले क्या बुरे हैं, हम सोचते हैं. बेटी. Just for people who understand Hindi, Saraswati is the goddess of knowledge, yet Saraswati working at home cannot write. Goddess Durga is the epitome of power, yet Durga in the real world is powerless. Shyam is the dark-skinned god of love and wisdom, yet the dark-skinned Radha is not accepted. If Sita is born at home, there is no celebration. Even the wisdom of Giridhar could not save Draupadi. The worshippers of Kali abuse me. If this is the state of women, then the people that kill and abort me in the wombs, are they really bad? One wonders. Pity. This next one is Ab Yaad Aate Ho Toh. This one is dedicated to, we had a show in Boston on Meena Kumari ji. So I always thought that what would Gulzar Sahab say to her? What would be his emotion? So this is basically, I am reciting to Meena Kumari ji, thinking that this is what he would say to her. Nostalgia is an emotion of an observer. It has shades of sadness, mild elation, acceptance, and serenity too. Yet, it's none of that. But how does one capture the essence of a special person in one moment? How does one do that? Ab yaad aati ho toh. उसी दिन बंद करती थी तुम्हारी खुशबू लम्हों में. उसी दिन बंद करती थी तुम्हारी खुशबू लम्हों में. अब याद आती हो तो छिड़क देता हूँ खुद पर कतरा कतरा वो लम्हा. अब याद आती हो तो छिड़क देता हूँ खुद पर कतरा कतरा वो लम्हा किसी नायाब इत्र की तरह. यादों की चादर लपेट लेता हूँ चुन चुन कर तुम में से खुद को समेट लेता हूँ. यादों की चादर लपेट लेता हूँ चुन चुन कर तुम में से खुद को समेट लेता हूँ. बहुत कुछ बाकी है अभी उस लम्हे में मुझ में बहुत कम. पर अब याद आती हो तो छिड़क देता हूँ खुद पर कतरा कतरा वो लम्हा किसी नायाब इत्र की तरह. जब कागजों पर करार किए हुए रिश्तों को तराजों में दम तोड़ते देखा तो हमने अपने बेनाम रिश्ते को जिस्मों से बचाकर वक्त के दो किनारों पर बांध लिया. हाँ कभी कभी उस पुराने पुल पर मिला करते थे. अब तुम्हारे हिस्से का पुल टूटा है और मेरा वेंटिलेटर पर उधार की सांसें फुर्सत से जी रहा है. अब तुम्हारे हिस्से का पुल टूटा है और मेरा वेंटिलेटर पर उधार की सांसें फुर्सत से जी रहा है. तुम्हारे हिस्से के रोजे मैंने रखे और मेरे हिस्से का तुम सो गई. कहाँ तुम खो गई कहाँ तुम खो गई, पर अब भी जब याद आती हो तो छिड़क देता हूँ खुद पर कतरा कतरा वो लम्हा किसी नायाब इत्र की तरह। The moment that we parted, I captured your essence. The day we parted, I captured your essence in a moment and sealed it. But of course, when I get nostalgic, I do spray a few drops of your essence on me, like an exotic perfume. I wrap myself in your memories, try to pick my scattered self from your magnanimous persona. We had seen the plight of relationships suffocating in the drawers and decided to save ours by keeping it away from the lust of human body and tied to the two ends of an ever-flowing river of time. Well, we did meet sometimes at the broken bridge. Now your part of the bridge is broken and mine is breathing the lone breaths. I fasted rosas on your behalf and you slept in death on my behalf. Yet, when I do miss you, I spray a few drops of that moment on me, like an exotic perfume. Ab yaad aati hai. जैसी ही अब मेहंदी गल गई तो हल्दी मल गई, मेहंदी गल गई तो हल्दी मल गई, माँ मैं भी तुझ जैसी ही घर गृहस्थी में ढल गई। सुबह सुबह मैं भी चिड़ियों संग उड़ जाती हूँ, बच्चों की वही शिकायतें, रोज रोज वही खाना क्यों बनाती हूँ। सुबह सुबह मैं भी चिड़ियों संग उड़ जाती हूँ, बच्चों की वही शिकायतें, रोज रोज वही खाना क्यों बनाती हूँ। देखो इसी सोच में फिर एक रोटी जल गई, माँ मैं भी तुझ जैसी ही घर गृहस्थी में ढल गई। दिल की बातों को जाने कितनी बार छुपाती थी, दिल की बातों को जाने कितनी बार छुपाती थी, हमारे लिए उपवासों से ईश्वर को धमकाती थी। मन्नत पूरी होने पर मंदिर नंगे पाँव चल गई, माँ मैं भी तुझ जैसी ही घर गृहस्थी में ढल गई। चेहरे बदल जाते हैं पर वक्त सब पर वही आता है, चेहरे बदल जाते हैं पर वक्त सब पर वही आता है, धीरे धीरे हर माँ का चेहरा बस माँ जैसा ही बन जाता है। चेहरे बदल जाते हैं पर वक्त सब पर वही आता है, धीरे धीरे हर माँ का चेहरा बस माँ जैसा ही बन जाता है। ना जाने कब मेरी कहानी तेरी कहानी में बदल गई, ना जाने कब मेरी कहानी तेरी कहानी में बदल गई, माँ मैं भी तुझ जैसी ही घर गृहस्थी में ढल गई।
I am Tanja Dückers from Berlin, from Germany. And I first want to thank the organizers of the festival to invite me to Bangalore Literature Festival. It's my first time in Bangalore and also my first time in India. I'm very happy to be here today. I will start with a few travel poems. Before I start, let me just say a few words about this volume of poems. It's called Fireman, and I've written the poems myself in English, in the English language, but of course I have native speakers correcting my poems. Of course my native language is German. First poem is set in Amsterdam, where I lived for a while. Moments. I walk in the streets of Amsterdam and spell the names of my friends in the rhythm of a children's verse. While I work on, I try to remember their faces, which I have stored in my head room, somewhere between marmalade jars, rusted screws, and old bikes. You know, Amsterdam is a city of bikes. I roam on, their addresses in my agenda blurred from yesterday's thunderstorm. The red Dutch letterboxes glow, red like hearts, or just the way letterboxes glow in this country. I turn around a corner. In front of me, a building pit with muddy footsteps, heavy big traces. They go astray, a few meters further on the right, in a puddle from yesterday's rain. Another poem set in New York. This is a bit about the nervousness and in a way also brutality of the city of New York. Fire escape. Rusty fire escapes loom in the burnt evening sky. Torn clouds kill crazy dreams. Roller skaters skip, fall, and die. Leaves fall from trees. Kisses as long as streets melt the asphalt. Gray ice cream rinses on a kid's fast ankles. Eyebrow rings, nose rings, lips ringing in potholes. Pink-green shoes disappear. Faint music hovers through night dust. Mashed melons fall into nowhere. No streetlights, no ground, New York. Rusted pennies crawl somewhere under the tattooed belly of a dead dog, still gnawing a squirrel's Central Park heart. Incredible red lips on a fire escape, soft dark tongue, rust around the mouth, murmur into the white of my eyes. The next poem is set in Finland, and it talks about a quite strange situation. I was visiting a friend of mine in Helsinki, capital of Finland, and she had fever and was very ill. So I was sort of her night watch, looking at her, taking care of her, and she was talking in her fever in her native language, in the Finnish language. Of course, I didn't understand a word of Finnish, but I was like fascinated by this strange situation. In this poem, I'm mentioning two geographical sites of Finland, a mountain called the Vuosikovaari, and then a lake, the Stora Lakes. Night watch, day in northern Finland. I am awake, listening to your breath, the whispering in your sleep, which I make note of laboriously, bent over a book full of blank pages. I stay awake like a clock, leave no syllable out of your mouth. I collect the strange Morse code you sent from somewhere. I turn my globe, search for the Vuosikovaari, for the Suora lakes you mention. While you turn in your sleep, leisurely, a tidal wave, you furrow pillows and coasts, and you speak again in your underwater language. Words I write down trembling, like signs scratched in bark or the sprinkled blood trace of somebody missing. Now a kind of love poem set in Italy on the island of Sicily. Chalk paintings. A piece of wood in one hand, painted with colorful chalk, the water will wash off again. On your head, the map of Sicily for sun protection. The snow of Etna on your forehead. We are waiting for a ship or the rain or the sun or for our lunch. I can't keep my thoughts together when I look at the ocean. I put wrong stems on letters, lose my watch, love you longer than usual. You paint with chalk on pieces of wood which you find here until lunch is ready or the rain comes or our ship, and then you throw them into the ocean. Now, after this love poem, I'm going to read a poem about self-love. Maybe you know the myth of Narcissus. So it's a poem about Narcissus and a kind of a way to reinterpret it. Narcissus again. He went out to the bridge to stare at his reflection in the water. As always, he couldn't detect any flaw when he scrutinized himself the last day. Nothing. 30 years the same face. 30 years of trying to escape from this face. He had been going out at night a lot, exposing, exhausting, overstimulating himself. Kisses of women glided down his face. He had collected their skins. In vain, he looked the same as ever. His boyish face, sweet, immaculate, always the same facial expression. The very moment he jumped and hit the water, his face completely distorted, dissolved in the endless embrace of the river. He died happily. Now, after some traveling, I come back to my hometown, to Berlin, with this poem called Secret Messages. And don't be astonished, it's about garbage cans. Lots of them in Berlin. Secret Messages. The city jingles her clockwork. High heels clatter their staccato above drains. Garbage cans ruminate love poems. And on the curbs of Berlin flow the utopias of the people waiting for the bus. The very moment they step on the footboard, they wipe them off quickly. In the garbage cans, in the second back courts, gnawed off lollipops, fish bones, potato skins, and old red socks are waiting. Below, empty washing up liquid bottles, broken off fields, torn letters, crumbled up complaint letters, smeary condoms, a tetrahoroscope, and ugly wedding presents finally thrown away. Sticks with blood-stained earwax, below notes decorated with swastikas, summonses and ads for capsules against impotency. Below dirty underpants, below instruction leaflets of tranquilizers and tear-soaking Kleenex, waits with insatiable curiosity the moist, panting bottom of the garbage can, captured in its grotto life, a narrow crack of daylight now and then, waits with insatiable curiosity the panting bottom of the garbage can for our next secret confession. And after reading a lot about traveling and finally about Berlin, I want to read to you a poem called Names, People, Incoherences. In a way about getting lost. Names, people, incoherences. In a faraway cave, a name is glowing on the walls. I've thrown all superfluous keys away. I found a piece of paper yesterday with some blurred initials on it. I found a key the day before yesterday, rusted, old, and halfway broken. I read names, street signs, and advertisements, and I don't understand a word. My neighbor attached no name next to his door nor to his letterbox. I know that his wife died a few weeks ago. My dead dog, which was found in a faraway cave, was called Incognito. Some people carry around their passport every day. A secret writing was slowly invented by me here on the grave floors. To hidden caves I go and risk getting lost. There, scratched with a rusty key and a candle in the other hand, my initials in the cold stone. Thank you. And I'm going to finish with three poems about writing. The first is a kind of homage to little words used in daily language we usually never pay attention to. Simple words like window, book, bread, words just loll about my room on a gray September day. Without context, a bit lost they stand, no they bump around my apartment, my sentences, scanty empty words like tundra, an alphabetical desert like an eremit, I hold monologues, scatter words like pebbles, washed round from September's rain, so usual words like almost, or yet, usual like tin cans. Today, words like and or very or still run about the sentence streets every day, hundreds of them in their long gray coats and their bent down backs. Words fall today coincidentally like dandruff from hair, fall meaninglessly like chewing gum on the ground. Words fall today a bit loose, out of my mouth full of junk. And the pre-last poem, it's again about roaming streets and about writing in words and about word inventions. Shoestringing. When I roam about the streets, I don't need to collect anything anymore or to take photos or decipher graffiti. The streets are only for walking, table, chair, legs, walking, brains, brim of the sky. I only think of word chains without end, every curbstone a word piece, every crack in the asphalt a new start. I read the street in order to enroll the word cluster of my room horizontally. I feel dizzy, I missed it. I dislike the straight walking like an arrow without curves or detours. The curves of the street curl my sentences. Stump bumbling, rolled cherries, aero touch mud, dick dog dizzy silly, toy letter text, beam long, longing, longing, wonder shoe stringing. When the street leaves me, I will walk on through skyscrapers, gardens, and garages, sweeping and talking, and somewhere I will get caught with my shoestrings on some rusted fence. And my last poem is called Words for Breakfast, and it's about how to say, about the shyness of an author to publish something. It's about the wish you sometimes feel as an author, as a poet, to keep your words for yourself, not to expose yourself. So, words for breakfast. My last poem today. I could write. I could try to think in words. I could crawl into a letter at night, sleep on paper, kiss your plastic mouth, library card. I could scratch my initials on loamy walls. I could force my lovely wet tongue into a red thick sentence. My spine, a curved word. I could translate the unreadable lines in my hands into a quiet murmur. Maybe I could write or try to speak, but I don't want to.
Thank you so much. Finally, my poems. I write in Kannada, so I'll read the original so that you can get the rhythm of the language for the people who don't speak Kannada. This is a poem on domestic violence. This poem is titled Yellavu Sariyagide. Hosa Badavaneya Chandada Mane. ಪುಟ್ಟ ಕೈತೋಟ ಅಚ್ಚುಕಟ್ಟು ಅಂಗಳದಲ್ಲಿ ಆರಾಮ್ ಕುರ್ಚಿ ಪಕ್ಕ ಪ್ರತಿಮೆಯಾದ ನಗುವ ಬುದ್ಧ ತೆರೆದು ಬಾಗಿಲು ಹೊರಬರುತ್ತಾನೆ ಅವನು ಹಿಂದೆ ನೆರಳಿನಂತೆ ಕರ್ಚೀಫು ಬ್ರೀಫ್ ಕೇಸು ಹಿಡಿದ ಅವಳು ಕೆನ್ನೆಗೆ ಕೆನ್ನೆ ತಗುಲಿಸಿದ ಮುತ್ತಿಟ್ಟನೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಕೈ ಬೀಸುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಹೊರಟ ಗಂಡನಿಗೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಅವನು ಕಂಡನೆ ಕೊನೆ ಗಣ್ಣಿಗೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕ ಬಿಂಬದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವನು ನಕ್ಕಂತೆ ಕಂಡದ್ದು ನಿಜವೇ ಖಾತ್ರಿಯಿಲ್ಲ ಅವನ ಬೆನ್ನು ತನ್ನ ಕಡೆಗಿರುವಾಗ ನಿಜ ಅರಿಯುವುದಾದರೂ ಹೇಗೆ ಪಕ್ಕದ ಮನೆಯವರಿಗೋ ಎದುರಿನವರಿಗೋ ಯಾರಿಗಾದರೂ ಕಂಡಿರಬಹುದು ಮನೆಯೊಳಗೆ ಕೆಲವೇ ಕ್ಷಣಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ರೇಡಿಯೋ ಸಿಟಿಯ ಹಾಡನ್ನು ಕುಕ್ಕರಿನ ಸಿಳ್ಳೆ ಮುಚ್ಚುತ್ತದೆ ನೆರೆಯವಳಿಗೆ ಚಿಲಕ ತಾಗಿತು ಎಂದು ಹೇಳಿದ ನೀಲಿಗಟ್ಟಿದ ತೋಳನ್ನ ಸವರುತ್ತಾಳೆ ಮುಚ್ಚಿದ ಬಾಗಿಲ ಹೊರಗೆ ಜಗತ್ತಿಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲವೂ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿದೆ ಎಂದು ತೋರಿಸುವುದು ಅದೆಷ್ಟು ಸುಲಭ ದ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್ ಗೋಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಈಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಅ ಫೈನ್ ಹೌಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಅಪ್ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆನ್ಷನ್ a small garden tour. Easy chair in the neat courtyard, right beside a laughing Buddha turned into a statue. Through the open door he breezes out. She follows on the toe like a shadow with his kerchief briefcase in hand. A breezy brushing of the cheek. Did he kiss? Don't know. She waves at him. Her husband. Did he see? Was it that the eye caught at the turn the laugh? Not sure. How could she know when he turned his back to her? Maybe the next house one may have seen. Within minutes, the cooker whistle drowns the Radio City music. She erases the bruise mark which has turned black and blue on her arm. What had she told the neighbor? That she had hit the door bolt? Beyond the closed doors, it's so very easy to show the world that all is well. This one, I'll directly jump into the translation. This is called One Side. The new gadgets, the computers, phones, are supposed to bring people together. But what are the gadgets doing now in the modern generation? This is a small piece on that. One Side. A full-length ad in the papers asking for applications. Happy family competition. Send us your family photo with a colorful smile. Attach your happy story, typed neat on one side of the page. I too apply, excited. Is this a family portrait? A girl for Aarti, a boy for Pride. My husband's knotted brows, daughter's blank look, Pokemon card peeking out of my son's pocket, my half-closed eyes blinded by the sudden flash, all frozen in a frame. We are a totally happy family. I write as they expect, on one side of the page. The unsaid other side whimpers. Our family, flat, car, home theater, all the serials we love explained in detail. Wishing very good morning, disappeared in the air without seeing each other faces. Flat dreams bidding good night like the press sheet spread on the cot. Mine is a happy family, driving out on weekend picnics. He is preoccupied with his business talk on his mobile. Daughter sways lost in a music world from the earplug. Shit, sways my son keying a new video game. On no one spares the look at the running trees swept by the drizzle, green carpets of paddy fields. I send a WhatsApp, wait for the replay. Four strangers in a car. We are together, united. I finish the write-up and show it to a friend. Oh, this is my story. Good, she approves. I show it to my bosom pal. So, you ridicule my family. Angry, she stops talking to me. Do you intend to apply? Please do take care to write on one side of the page. Thank you so much. So after the poetry, it is always silence. That's what I prefer. But they kept the session open for discussion. If anybody wants to ask any questions, there are only two questions allowed. Yeah.
Coincidence was quite near.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not talking about your poem.
yeah, poetry with a reality. It was quite a coincidence of equations. And of course, the madam was sitting next to you. You know, I thought the look you were of situation, the way you spoke, I think we can't give you more tongue to spell better. The way of your poetry I'm talking about. The Americanized way of way of approach to things. The language could not be bent more to accentuate the language. Yeah, that's I think was quite well done. I suppose I'm not talking about anything in particular. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Anyone else?
Okay, my question is regarding poetry. What do you see the future of satires and poetry? And how long is it going to live?
You said how long is satire going to live? I think as long as we live, satire is in motion.
Nowadays we are all working in the blank verses and all. This is about looking in the life through a very rational perspective. So people generally want to actually hear the truth all rather than go, you know, swinging their brains around and going through the other way. So satire, you know, it's very subtle nowadays.
Right. Do you write it? Like,
yeah, I do write.
So blog. That would be. I think we would need somebody like you to tell us the truth as it is. And some of us may not handle it, that's fine. Some of us like sugar coated. We have enough poets for that. So you are welcome to the drive.
So thank you. Thank you very much.
Sir Elisa.
Thank you, panelists. That was a wonderful session indeed. I would now request the panelists to sign on the BLF wall. Those who wish to get their book signed, kindly head to the signing area right behind the help desk. Since this edition is dedicated to the memory of late Dr. U.R. Anandamurthy, do visit a photo exhibition of him in the cafeteria. Inquisition, the BLF Books Quiz by Nexus Consulting, is from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. at the bookstore and the documentary is being screened at the bookshop till 2:30 p.m. Everyone is invited to participate. This year the BLF is not simply about the written word. We have at the festival a wonderful showcase of contemporary art and sculpture. BLF, in association with our venue and hospitality partner, Crown Plaza, Bengaluru, Electronic City, proudly presents Forms, Faces, Forces, an exhibition celebrating motives and motions that books bring alive. Curated and conceptualized by Gallery G, the exhibition is on at the Crown Plaza Hotel lobby as well as in the festival area. Thank you.
ಆ ಚೇರ್ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರೆ.